I'm very excited to have this conversation. Buckle up because it is going to be a lot of fun. Let me share with you who's joining us today. So first up, we have Haley Moss, who is an all-around awesome person, lawyer, disability, neurodiversity advocate, prolific author. You might have seen her on Teen Vogue or what, CNN. You're just like all over the place lately.
You make me sound so important, but thank you, because it's just an honor to get to be with everyone. And again, I'm really excited that we're talking about Disability Pride today.
Awesome. And a new face out there might be, actually for me, our new marketing intern at Positive Development, Libby Parent. Now, she is an incredible artist, a creative writer, and also a college student at SCAD. So Libby, welcome.
Hi. So nice to be here. Thank you.
Awesome. So you guys, like we said, it is Disability Pride Month. And actually, Haley, do you mind just sharing a little bit about what is it? What's that all about?
Okay. So Disability Pride Month really started taking off, whether it was originally as a day or a week at first, after the passage of the Americans with Disabilities Act. That is why we host Disability Pride in July. So for those of you who might not know, the Americans with Disabilities Act was signed on July 26th of 1990. It is older than both Libby and I, so we've had plenty of time to be familiar with this fancy little piece of civil rights legislation that has made a lot of lives of disabled people better. And when we had the 25th anniversary, New York City really began celebrating Disability Pride and having different events surrounding it. It was really powerful to see. I actually got to learn a lot about this through a piece in Forbes by Andrew Polrang. I'll have to share that with everybody later, and especially in a future write-up, because it's just, there's so much that we don't talk about. And I think when we think about disability history and even disability pride, it's something that we're not usually taught. It's something that I know as a neurodivergent person, I had to learn a lot of myself. And I say this very kind of embarrassed in a way, is I didn't really know the history of my own people, that we had this kind of long fight for disability rights and even being included, that the modern disability rights movement, as we know, it really began in the 70s and whatnot, but it's been so much work after and before that. So it's always really powerful to learn and know more, and also just get to have a culture and people to celebrate with and to be proud of who you are.
Well said. So Libby, have you ever been, like, have you ever celebrated Disability Pride before?
Actually, I was diagnosed when I was like 13, 14. Mm-hmm. But through my friendship with Haley is really when I started to like become more aware of my background, because mm-hmm. This is gonna sound weird, I didn't know I was actually disabled until I was talking to Haley and she was like, oh yeah, well, you're neurodiverse. And I was like, what? Mm-hmm. And so it was kind of me just recently learning kind of what that meant and that I'm part of something kind mm-hmm. of bigger than myself, which is like amazing. But no, I wasn't aware that I was even categorized really as disabled. So for me, learning that this month now holds a whole new meaning for me.
Well said. So let me ask you that. So, you know, the labels, we were talking about labels earlier, and, mm-hmm. you know, like, so not knowing, you know, like disability was maybe a term that you could use to describe yourself. What is the impact of labels? And because I know some people it really helps, others not so much. Thoughts there?
I think both of us probably have a lot to contribute to this conversation. And yeah. I think, for me, because I was very privileged to have a diagnosis and a label since I was a child, that at least when I first heard about it as a young person, I thought, okay, this makes sense. And I didn't think anything that I was like different or anything. I thought that everyone else was just weird and I was really cool, because that's mm-hmm. how my parents always framed everything. But for me, I thought, okay, this makes a lot of sense. This tells me a little bit more about myself. I think for a lot of people, a diagnosis is, if anything, a jumping off point to either receiving services and accommodations, especially young people and people in the workplace or in school, or for a lot of older adults as well, if maybe you don't need formal services or you might not be requesting formal accommodations, it's a really powerful self-discovery tool.
I totally agree. I think that the labels in general, I'm not saying specifically about labels, but more so learning about who you are as a person and what happens mm-hmm. in your brain. I think that's a tool to be used in your favor. I don't think that it makes you less than perfect. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I think that a lot of people are scared to learn what they are because then I have to say that I am this, or then I have to admit that I'm not neurotypical. And whoever said that you had to be neurotypical to not be broken is my question. Mm-hmm. Because learning that I was neurodiverse has not only enhanced my life for the better, but it has made me so much more aware of why I am the way I am and mm-hmm. why that's okay that I am the way I am.
I think it also creates a lot of self-compassion because I think about the labels that we might have if we didn't have access to a diagnosis or even that discovery of, oh, I'm neurodivergent, or, oh, I have autism or a mental illness or a psychiatric disability, et cetera, is think about the labels that society has already given us of you're crazy, you're lazy, you're unmotivated, you're difficult or stubborn. Think about all of these other labels that society will give you instead. And I think this kind of goes to this larger conversation about internalized ableism when you eventually begin to believe that stuff about mm-hmm. yourself. Mm-hmm. But I feel like being like, oh, you know, maybe I'm not lazy. I'm just autistic and my brain has a harder time getting it together to go through all these different steps or absolutely. Making sure that a certain thing gets done on time. I think having that, I have that grace and compassion with myself of, hey, no, even though this particular institution or system is telling me I'm lazy, that doesn't mean it's true. That means that there is something else going on in my brain. It doesn't mean that I'm broken or that I'm wrong. It just means this is how it is. And yeah, I think it really does create that kindness, at least to yourself, even if not everyone else understands.
I absolutely mm-hmm. agree. And I think to like carry off of that, before I even learned that I had a diagnosis, I was masking long before. I mean, I was trying to act like I was neurotypical without even understanding that's what I was doing. I was trying to fit in. And I was like, why am I having such a hard time fitting in to this private school group? Why is this like so much more difficult for me to do than for my peers to do? And it never occurred to me that I had an answer, if that makes sense. Like I could have had that answer a long time ago, but it never occurred to me that there was a reason for why I was acting this way or why it was so hard for me to kind mm-hmm. of mesh into that surrounding. So mm-hmm. I think like learning what my labels were, I guess, helped me understand that like, this is why I am. mm-hmm. And like, it's okay that I'm like, that I was masking for so long. It's okay that I couldn't really find my place for so long because now I found my place and it's way more accepting than any other group that I would ever want to be a part of. So
I love that. Okay. So let's unpack a term you use there, Haley. Okay. Ableism. So explain to everyone what ableism is.
Okay. Whenever I have to actually teach this to a group, I have a very fancy definition from the Center for Disability Rights that explains how it's like a set of practices and attitudes that basically devalues disabled people based on what we're told about disability, what disability is and isn't, and not having a seat at our own table, all of these different things. But the bare bones definition that I usually give is that it's a series of attitudes and stereotypes that negatively affect people with disabilities. Yep. So this can look like a lot of different things. It could be very obvious, such as discrimination or maybe something being completely inaccessible, or it can also be a lot more subtle. It could be very ingrained into our culture, like our language, or it can even be something that we see as kind and caring and we don't realize that we're doing things that are harmful towards disabled and neurodivergent people. So that at least is what I define as benevolent ableism, and that's a whole conversation of it in and of itself because that's, and the way that I'll define that very simply is when I am offered assistance that is neither wanted nor needed mm-hmm. because mm-hmm. when most people make these decisions, they do it from a very kind and caring place, but it really just robs me of having any independence or self-advocacy to make my own decision, say, no, I got this. It's okay. Or, hey, I want to join everybody at this event, even though I don't drink alcohol or I don't want the food being served. Don't just not invite me because you know this about me. So mm-hmm. I think it's really kind of difficult to unpack. But ableism is something all of us are guilty of, and it's not because we're bad people. I think that's something I really want to kind of clarify when we have this conversation.
You're trying to be a good person.
Exactly, especially benevolent ableism, but a lot of us have these attitudes and beliefs because we haven't really been taught a lot about disability. We don't know how to act around something that makes us uncomfortable,
yeah.
Or we just simply don't know better.
You know, I right. also like ableism kind of came differently for me, I think in high school more so, because mm-hmm. that was like when I was really starting to explore like my mental illness and what it was and what I could do with it with art. And I think that, like, I was given passes, but more so I was given praise for, like, being neurodiverse. And my art teacher used to go, oh, well, she's a mentally ill artist. And that was, like, my title. That was, like, oh, she's mentally ill. That's why she's so brilliant. And I said, no, no. And whether or not that was benevolent ableism is a whole nother topic. But I do think that there was some misguided stereotypes there. I think that I was expected to be like this revered artist because I was mentally ill, when in reality I was an artist who is mentally ill, but that's not my title. So mm-hmm. I don't know. I found a lot of ableism more so in high school.
How do you navigate that? Like, when you're given a title like that, is how do you navigate that and say like, hey, this is a part of my identity, but it's not the only thing that defines me or my artwork. I think that's something I'm still trying to figure out myself.
Yeah. Well, when I was 18, it was really weird because I really admired this teacher too, which is like the craziest thing. She really helped me get my art to a point where I was really proud of it. And so I felt kind of weird coming at her like that and being like, no, like, oh, I don't really like that. Like, that's not really who I am. And I kind of steered away from it, I think. Mm-hmm. And towards the end, I really, like, I don't know, I was about to graduate. And it felt weird that, like, she was going to be teaching her class, and then she's just going to mention me as this mentally ill artist that she used to have. And it kind of, like, struck a chord. And so I kind of just pulled her aside, and I was like, being mentally ill is not something to be praised because of. I am mentally ill, but I did not ask for it. I did not choose it. And I am not an artist because I am mentally ill, which is, I think, what she thought. Mm-hmm. And I tried to tell her in the kindest way possible, but I still think it was kind of like she thought she had done something so wrong. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that like a lot of people tend to beat themselves up when they realize, oh, I am being ableist.
Yep. Yep.
When in reality, you should not feel bad. I mean, I don't think you should feel bad for being ableist and not knowing that you're being ableist.
Yeah.
But rather, I just kind of wanted to make it known that, like, I don't like being praised for something I have no control over.
Yeah, and, you know, it was interesting. In preparing for this, you know, like, it's a term I wasn't really familiar with, ableism. And so I encourage everybody to just, you know, do a little bit of research and just, like, learn, like, and read about it a little bit. Mm-hmm. But, you know, once you hear about some examples of things, you think, oh my gosh, I've done that. Oh, you know,
I've done it too.
Yeah. And I just think, you know,
I think that's something we got to make sure we throw out there, that even yeah. being disabled or neurodivergent yourself doesn't mean that you haven't been ableist, especially mm-hmm. towards either your own group or classification or other disabled people. So that doesn't yeah. mean that I haven't done things that might be harmful to people with intellectual disabilities.
Absolutely.
Or people with physical disabilities, et cetera. So we can all be susceptible to this in some way, shape, or form. So it's something that I think everyone has to be conscious of. And again, be kind to yourself.
Yes.
When and you know better, you do better.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And that's why, like, I love these conversations because, I mean, heck, I'm learning a ton, mm-hmm. But it just increases my heart and my openness mm-hmm. to want to do better. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. We have a question that came up, and I think this is a good one. Speaking of labels, recently heard that there are some starting to use the term neuromajority over neurotypical. Never heard this term before. Curious to know, you know, what are your thoughts, and is there a term that's preferred over another?
I think I like that, even though I also have not heard of a neuromajority, really. But
I have not heard of it.
I think the thing that makes me a little weird about it is, does that mean that everyone who's neurodivergent is a neurominority? Because I know that there's a lot of talk, and I've learned this from other educators, about why saying minority isn't always helpful or it's harmful. So I know whenever instead I'm saying what do you mean to say instead of minority? There's a really great lesson on this on Instagram Reels from Blair Imani, if you follow her. And she talks about that usually when people say minority, they mean things like marginalized by society. They mean historically oppressed. They mean all of these other things. And it's really interesting, especially because that term is used for BIPOC folks, is that they're the global majority. So I think a neuromajority is also a really interesting thought, but I don't think neurominority is its opposite works. I guess that's kind of how my brain is kind of sorting through this, but I also think that neurotypical people might want to be considered a neuromajority because they don't like the way neurotypical sounds or they think it's an insult. I'm not really sure, but I think that we're all trying to convey this same concept. I think that the one thing that happens, at least when we talk about neurotypes, is people think that neurotypical is synonymous with not autistic.
Yeah.
And they don't realize that neurotypical means many different things, just like neurodivergent means many different things. Mm-hmm. So even hearing Libby and I today, like, we do not have the same neurodivergences. And you can be multiply neurodivergent. We do not have the exact same form of neurodiversity, but that doesn't mean that either of us are neurotypical. That we do share.
And alternatively, I think it's interesting that we don't have the same divergency, but we do have similarities in us, which I think, I think it's kind of cool.
Because
we could be just be talking about something random like ADHD or whatever the case may be, and bipolar is classified very closely to ADHD to kind of get confused sometimes. So if I have a certain thing or mannerism that I go about doing, and Haley's like, oh my god, I do the same thing, or if Haley has one that I do, and I'm like, I never knew that was because of this. So I think it's really interesting that you just start to like draw these lines and ties between. I always thought it was so cool.
You know what's a blast about you guys is
what?
Joy. And I just love those moments of discovery, you know.
I think that's what disability pride. I think that's something that's so important to disability pride, is actually sharing that joy and celebrating that identity, because we see disability, we see neurodiversity as these problems that need to be solved and these scary unknowns. And think about even when they show our journeys on TV, that it's something to be solved. It's a form of pain that a character has to endure or another character has to endure, and the side character helps them grow or whatever. But you see stories of neurodivergent and disabled pain and tragedy. But you don't get to see that joy. And especially for people who are multiply marginalized, so women, people of color, et cetera, who are also disabled in some way, is there so much focus on our pain and our struggle that what disability pride, I think, really does is it shows that joy. And when you see that joy, when our hands are moving or we're smiling or we're talking about things we love, that it is a very rebellious act compared to what people are expecting. What disability pride means. It's a form of rebellion. It's like existing is a form of resistance and having a life that matters and is full of things that are good.
I totally agree. Like, being disabled obviously comes with its obstacles. It's not without trial. But I think that everyone wants to focus on the obstacles. When in reality, like, I don't know, I couldn't be happier with the life I was given, and I wouldn't change it for the world. I remember Haley once like asked, if you had a reset button, would you press it? And I said, no. No, I'm really happy with who I turned out to be. Whether or not I have my fair share of obstacles, it's turned me into, I think, the person that I would choose anyway, you know?
Okay, let's talk community for a second. You know, I mean, I know from just personal experience, I mean, just the loneliness that can exist. How do you find your people?
I think the first time I ever felt seen and met other autistic people was at a conference and I was a teenager. Because I think what happens, especially this is something that I think a lot of parents do, and that's super well-meaning and probably the only thing that I might actually fault families for regularly, is that they don't give us access to other people like us. And whether that's because they're afraid we might learn too much from them in a special education setting, or they're afraid that we don't identify with those disabled people, quote, quote, because they think they might have more support needs, or we'll pick up on other neurodivergent habits in a world that wants us to be more neurotypical or able-bodied, whatever it might be. But when you meet your people for the first time and you realize you're not alone, that is something you can never take away. When you find someone who has a similar life experience or a shared diagnosis and you don't have to say it, but you feel this, I see you and I hear you for everything that you are, because I also have that experience. And the first person I had that with at the time was a college student. I was going to be entering high school, and I had to visit a school in Tampa last year, 2 years ago, actually. This was 2019. And I got to speak to a group of middle school girls. And at this, in that classroom was a bunch of just neurodiverse learners. And it was all teenage girls. And it was the first time they had that same moment that I remember having with a college student, of that they felt seen and heard, because it was the first time they met an adult with the same diagnosis outside of that cluster classroom or outside of that setting, that they realized, oh, wow, there are people like me who exist and I'm not alone. Because I think, like you're saying, and I know this is true for parents of kids with disabilities or who have neurodivergent children too, is you feel alone. My parents will regularly comment on how alone they felt in raising me, and I don't blame them for that whatsoever. It's hard to find your people, whether you're a parent or it's your life experience. Mm-hmm. And I know that you could definitely speak to that parent perspective, Stacey, but I think that when you find your people, however you do, whether it's online or through a support group, or you just get lucky enough that you meet other people who have a similar life trajectory in a way, you're like, oh my gosh, I feel seen and heard. And it's such a powerful thing. A lot of my friends are other autistic people, other neurodivergent people, other disabled people. And I think it enriches my life in ways I didn't know that I needed. I think for me, it's this, I feel seen. I feel heard. I don't have to follow the rules in the same way. I'm not apologizing for who I am.
Yay.
You know,
so how did you guys meet?
Oh, okay. Sorry. Happy hands. we met through a mutual friend. Classified information. we met through a mutual friend, and I think we kind of just spiraled from there. Like, the first night we started texting, it was like an all-night thing. And I want to mention that I went to a private grade school, so I didn't have that outlet to like know who I was. And when I got to high school, I met some people who were like me, but never have I met someone who could really tell me who I was, or kind of show me like who I was, you know. And when I started talking to Haley, I remember the first time she said, "You are validated," and I cried. I don't even know.
Oh my gosh. I didn't know this. Now I want to just give you a hug. It's so funny to me, because I remember even going, I also went to private school for up until college, and I never met other people like me. I think the next time after, outside of just advocacy spaces, that I met another autistic person, I met somebody in a support group that I went to once in college. I felt very uncomfortable at this group because it was neurotypical led and very forced conversation, not just letting us exist as a bunch of autistic college students. But when I got to law school in my final year, I met a classmate who was also autistic. She was a transfer student. And now she's someone I actually get to work with closely as a colleague. She's at a big firm. She heads up their disability affinity group there. She's also on the spectrum. And it was like, we both had this kind of understanding, and we bounced off so many things professionally off each other. Like, hey, how did you navigate disclosure? How did you navigate this? As we had this kind of understanding that we knew none of our other peers would. So it's always a really powerful feeling when you find those people. And sometimes it happens because you have a mutual friend. Sometimes it happens because you are in a space that is designed for and by people like you, or you just get lucky.
So Haley and I actually met when I was 21. And then she was there for my 22nd birthday. And I am not ashamed to say that before her, I had never had that sort of validation. I could talk about it. I talked about it with my boyfriend constantly, but it was never something like, he's not going to kind of give me that validation that I needed. You know, he's not going to know how to do that. Mm-hmm. And so he's a great support system to have, and he always listens. He always takes it into his mind, thinks about it, lets me know what he thinks. But having someone with similar life experiences telling me that I was validated was like a weight off my shoulders. I was like, wow, I never heard that before. That felt really good. Can you say that again? say it for the people in the back. Like,
there are so many times that I talk to you and I feel like I'm looking at who I was at 21 and 22. I say that a lot. I know I've said that a lot to you over the last couple months. I'm like, hey, this feels eerily familiar. And I think that kind of even when you're talking about your boyfriend, what's making me have feelings. And I think that maybe this is a question for Stacey, but as seemingly neurotypical allies, how do you want to instill that sense of pride and identity so that we feel comfortable talking about who we are with you or sharing some of those experiences that you might not have that same, I see you in the same way that, for instance, Libby and I might be having that, I see you when I hear you, but you see us. Even if you know that you might not understand it completely because it's not your life experience, how do you proceed as an ally, I guess?
Oh, I'm so glad. I'm so glad you asked that because I again, am learning so much. And, you know, the idea of number one, slowing down. For me, like, I don't need to solve everything like every minute, you know, so slowing down, being present and listening, I'm learning. I don't want to speak for, other people. I don't want to speak for my kids. I want to let them speak. I want to encourage them and empower them to share their stories and use their voice. So I've learned, you know, instead of just probably jumping in and answering something, sometimes I'll say, you know, kiddo, what do you think about that? I'm also really inspired. I'm listening to this and I'm thinking, you guys, okay, with what? One out of every 54 people at this point are diagnosed with autism and how that number is growing and growing. There are neurodiverse, you know, there are people out there. How do we connect you? And
exactly.
And two, how do we do it at a young age where it's not until you're like in college that you're finding your people? How can we facilitate that sooner? So anyway,
that's such a great question though. And not only do we have this like one in 54 people are autistic and who knows how many are undiagnosed or unidentified, but I saw a number not too long ago. Oh my gosh, please don't cry. I want to hug you too. But kind of sidebar on that is I had to cite a statistic not too long ago that if you look at all types of neurodiversity, so mental health and psych disabilities, learning disabilities, ADHD, intellectual disabilities, acquired neurodiversity like Alzheimer's, dementia, traumatic brain injuries, autism, et cetera, you have a number that comes out to closer to about 1 in 7 people might be neurodivergent. So this is a really big, and we already know 1 in 4 people in America today meets the criteria of having a disability. That's about 61 million people. So when we think about how big neurodiversity really is, and I always try to hammer home that neurodiversity is not a synonym for autism. It's a really big tent. It's a really big umbrella. Yeah. You might not know you're neurodivergent, even if you are. Looking at Libby, who learned that very recently, relatively speaking, as someone who we've figured out is not autistic, but definitely falls in this umbrella. So I think it's really important that we make sure that when we have these conversations and we include neurodiversity in our disability pride celebrations and our conversations, that we're very mindful of just how many people really do fall under there. And of course, you can be multiply neurodivergent.
You know, I do want to mention from what Stacey was talking about. Stacey, you do this wonderful thing. You nod your head and you listen to people while they're talking. I go off on tangents and sometimes my mind can't get words in order. It's a byproduct of multiple mental illnesses. I just can't decipher what I want to say sometimes. And I realize that sometimes I take these pauses or I can't kind of, I get jumbled and my head doesn't know where I want to go next. But when I'm talking to you in specific, you do this thing where you nod your head approvingly. And I don't even know if you know you're doing that. But it is like extensively helpful to someone who is constantly going through that train of self-doubt every time that she talks. Because maybe I'm okay with who I am now, but that lingering, oh God, you're making a fool of yourself when you talk because you're stuttering so much, that always stays. So like for me, I'm talking to you and you're nodding approvingly and I'm seeing you nod and then I'm like, I can keep going. I can do this. I can talk. And that is just a wonderful thing to display, whether you know that you're doing it or not. It's a great habit to pick up because I'm no longer scared to like get my thought out. Then that's, I don't know. That's really
assuring. Okay. I'm totally crying.
Meanwhile, I'm like, oh wait, and I'm listening to this and I'm going, I didn't even notice that Stacey nods her head. I must've missed a fundamental social cue.
That's the first thing I noticed about her.
See, that's so interesting. And I'm just like trying to focus on what you're saying. And I'm like, oh, yeah. And now I'm going to be looking saying, oh, wow, there is this extra form of validation. This is so cool.
The first time that I met Stacey, I was talking to her and I went off on a tangent. I knew I went off on a tangent too. And I was like, oh boy, okay. My head's going. And then all of a sudden I saw Stacey nod and I was like, huh, all right, well, back to my story. Like, it was just like very comforting. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Well, I'll tell you what, too, as a mom, like, I want to be the house that everybody, like, all my kids' friends feel comfortable. Like, you know, I just want to be that place mm-hmm. where kids can gather, too. I don't know. That's another thing that I think about a lot, too.
That was my house growing up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Nobody wanted to leave. And oftentimes I think it's because people liked my mom better than me. If you talk to my mom for any length of time, I can see why people feel that way. Honestly, she makes you feel more at home than I probably know how to do. And it's not that I don't care and I don't love you, but she's really good at that hospitality thing. And also she always designed our house, even when I was growing up, to be that place that people wanted to come for play dates. And a lot of that was because, at least growing up as someone who struggled socially, it was easier to be in control of the situation. And I'm sure you might have had that with your sons as well, as even this like, oh, if we're in control, we can know when the friends are leaving. If my kid's having a hard time, we can divert accordingly. So there was always this control, but we also had a fun house. Like, I don't always tell this story, but there was always a pinball machine in my house when I was a kid. This was not my great decision, I promise. This was not me coming up with this on my own. My dad got it from my mom as a birthday gift one year because she wanted it in our old house. We had no space. It used to be in our living room. And then it ended up migrating towards the back of the house. But anytime anyone would come over, whether it was kids or adults, they always wanted to just play with the pinball machine. So we were automatically the fun house. And it was just like little things like that that helped us stay in control of a situation of, okay, people want to go to the Moss house because they're fun. And my mom's also like, not only are we fun, but we're in control of a social situation. So we have toys, games, structure, et cetera. So nobody's getting overwhelmed, but also everybody feels safe. It was genius looking back, because you have to remember
that is genius.
My mom was parenting and doing all this stuff. This was like early aughts. This was a different world. And I always had to remind people.
The nowadays.
I have to remind people my mom was early 2000s parenting here doing this type stuff.
Yeah.
Because everyone's like, oh, wow, that sounds. I'm like, she was truly ahead of her time. So hats off to mom.
And
mom powers, where you want to be the person that everyone wants to hang out with. And then I had friends that would open up to my mom instead of me, and I never understood why, but now I do. I would open up to my mom instead of me.
You know, just thinking the neighborhood dynamic for a second. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know that we really struggled mm-hmm. with neighbors who didn't understand, and we didn't understand, you know, some of the outbursts and like, you know, getting super excited. You can get a little bit out of control and things. Anyway, I think that is, if you're a parent listening, like that is a genius idea right there, is have something positive that all the kids will want to come and hang out with you. I love that.
And then somehow strategize it to make it an educational moment for your child, or give them that structure that they crave, because I needed structure a lot. And my mom, if anything, is very organized and very good at structure. So yeah. Not only did other kids want to hang out, I got the structure that I needed.
Oh, good stuff.
I wish that everything had structure still, and now I can't stick to it, but that's a whole other conversation.
It's all good. All right, let's, you know, something that I find really interesting, actually pandemic stuff. You know, when you talk about like putting yourself in somebody else's shoes and, you know, taking a walk around. That's like one of my favorite quotes from To Kill a Mockingbird. But, you know, I've heard it said that it kind of, for people who were doing like online, a lot of video things, and it was very unnatural for some people, it kind of leveled the playing field. Can you talk about like what you've seen pandemic wise and raising awareness maybe?
I'm going to punt to Libby because she went to school virtually, which is an experience I don't have. And I think that's absolutely fascinating. And a lot of people with kids or college students, et cetera, probably are thinking about that, especially as we go into August somehow. So punt.
I fidget. I fidget a lot. I fidget with everything. Anything that's around me, you can see me rocking my chair back and forth. I am fidgeting. In class, if you're in an in-school setting, professionalism is very important, I think, especially in college careers, is you want to be perceived as a professional adult because you are entering this very adult world. So fidgeting, I think, in a lot of people's minds, is kind of like a kid's game. Like, oh, you're fidgeting with your fingernail, you're fidgeting with a piece of plastic, we put that down, be professional, hands in front of you. I can't do that. I can't focus on anything if I'm not fidgeting. To be able to learn in a virtual setting not only gave me the freedom to pick up something and fidget with it, but it gave me the freedom to listen how I need to listen to you. I don't listen like I my counter, like, or my peers do. I don't listen in that way. I do a lot of things with my hands, and I count on them, and I repeat words in my head, and sometimes I draw words on my hand to, like, remember what you said. And I do these things, and I think it looks like I'm being rude and kind of that in-ground session, but being able to do it virtually gave me the freedom to, like, be able to hear you the way I need to hear you in order for to learn. And then there's also that dynamic of, I have bipolar disorder, and some days are hard enough for me to get out of bed. I don't think anyone understands, or people understand who have been through it, but this is not like, ah, God, I'm just too tired today. No, this is like, I physically cannot move my body to put one foot on the ground and get out of bed. My mind will not allow me to do that. So the freedom of either being able to not attend the virtual class and just post online, or attend the virtual class but stay in bed in order to do that, I mean, it gave me an entire sense of, like, wow, I can get through school. And if I can get through school, I can get a good job. And if I can get a good job, then I'm an adult.
I'm an adult.
Adult level unlocked.
I think that kind of going off of that, I think that this virtual world opened up so much for all people with disabilities, really. And when you're talking about attending class from bed, it makes me think of this piece from the New York Times that I read a while ago about how people with chronic illnesses are like, oh, great, we get to work from bed again. Is that it's not seen as this, like, pinnacle of lazy so much as a, oh, this thing that we need to do because our bodies and brains are working in this particular way. I just love knowing that that's a thing. I also fidget all day long too, so it's not just you. And I'm like, I just got also very excited when you were showing us, and then Stacy pulled out her fidget toys. Like, I'm always fidgeting too. It's just, and it's funny because I'm able to, I guess, mask it a little bit better online because you don't see my hands every time that we do a live stream or every time I have to give a presentation. But I realize I have more freedom to do that than I did when things were always in person. But on the converse, I do think it's harder because there's always pressure to have your camera on no matter what you're doing. And in so many times, I find that very distracting because I just end up staring at myself and wonder what my face is doing.
Yes. And that's really one of my kids really struggled
with that. So when I teach class at this time too, like I have an undergrad class that I taught last semester, and I'm teaching them in the fall over Zoom as well. And I tell them, like, look, I trust you. If you log in and you have to turn your camera off, I'm not going to be mad at you or think you're not here. I'm trusting that you're doing this because it's an access need. Maybe you don't want us to see that you're taking care of kids. Maybe you can't focus if you see your own cute little face. I love your face. I would love to see your faces, but it's okay if I can't. And I get distracted. I sit on Zooms all the time too. And there are days that it's like, what if I'm not up for this, or I can't make eye contact, or I can't focus because there's cameras on. And I think that pressure to constantly have cameras, and I know coming from, I was working from home pre-pandemic a little bit too, before I would be on days that I wasn't traveling for work, and everything used to just be phone calls. And now there's so much pressure to see your face that everything is a Zoom or a please show me your face meeting. And part of it's kind of uncomfortable, but it's not easier for me to read people by any means. But I think it makes it a different level of pressure at times too. So I'm like, wow, this has opened so much. There's educational opportunities I might have never had. Certain things have captions, certain events with authors, and all sorts of really cool stuff. And I've gotten to speak at places that otherwise might not have had the budget or time or event space or whatever it might have been to make something happen, that I've gotten to work with people I might have never worked with before. So I think it's been great in a lot of ways, but in other ways, I think that we have to be mindful that this could still be really difficult.
You know, because I wanted to add on, because I go to such a widely international school, there's people from all over attending. Not everyone can be expected to kind of like tune in to these live Zoom sessions. Mm-hmm. So I actually opt for their route and I watch the recorded one after, because mm-hmm. I do know that also social cues are still a thing. And even if you're on Zoom, social cues come into play all the time, and I don't have kind of the know-how to navigate through Zoom yet, what my social cues are, and if I can do them while looking at my face, it distracts me, mm-hmm. Which is why when I also talk, I look away if I'm on Zoom, mm-hmm. because mm-hmm. trying to see how I'm supposed to navigate certain expressions, it just confuses me more. So mm-hmm. I often attend those recorded ones because it's just less pressure to have to kind of mask this mm-hmm. know-how, you know? Mm-hmm.
I think if you're able to do what you have to do, it doesn't matter how it gets done.
Yeah.
I agree.
And I think people aren't very good at kind of noticing that, hey, sometimes things happen on a different timetable. So I used to joke a lot that I run on disabled standard time, that things get done. You might not know when or how, but it will get done, likely on time. I will tell you if it won't. I don't know how, because there are times it might get done 5 minutes before. There might be times it's done 5 days in advance. Nobody really knows. Or I might have totally thought the deadline was 3 weeks ago. I had to book an appointment for something today, actually. And I thought I made it for August 4th. And it turns out I made it for September 8th because it was like in that same column, I guess, on the scheduler. And then she's like, didn't you mean August 4th? And I was like, right. And then you're just like, oh my gosh, I am such a screw up. And it turns out that sometimes you know people who are really good about things, but it happens.
Totally. We're kind of coming to the end, I think, of our time today. And, you know,
oh my gosh,
I know. Can you believe it? I mean, this feels like 5 minutes. I always hope with these discussions that, you know, being exposed to something new, something different, I hope that, you know, everyone's heart, I think of the Grinch, right? Your heart becoming a little bit bigger and, you know, that door of acceptance opening just, you know, another crack. But, you know, I guess how can we all celebrate, let's end on this. How can we all celebrate Disability Pride Month? What's something practical maybe that we could do to support the community, to celebrate? I don't know. What are your thoughts?
Listen and learn. I think you've celebrated with us perfectly today. I don't have anything more intelligent to add.
No, I completely agree with that.
Sweet. Well, I guess, you know, drop the mic. We'll end it there. you guys, thank you for joining and tuning in, or if you're watching this later, totally cool. We will, you know, in the comments, share links of anything that we talked about today. Use the comments, get connected, and let us know, like, if there are other things that you would love to learn about, or topics, you know, that maybe we could just discuss in the future, please let us know. We're totally interested in hearing what you guys want to know. So thank you for joining us. Happy Disability Pride Month. And you guys, I think you're the greatest, and I just love talking to you.
Always a pleasure.
The feeling is mutual.
Awesome. All right, everyone, have a great weekend. We'll see you next week.
Bye.
Bye.